chapter 5.
Glory to you, O Lord.
When Jesus had again crossed over by boat to the other side of the lake, a large crowd gathered around him while he was by the lake. Then one of the synagogue leaders named Jairus came, and when he saw Jesus, he fell at his feet. He pleaded earnestly with him, "My little daughter is dying. Please come and put your hands on her so that she will be healed and live." So Jesus went with him. A large crowd followed and pressed around him. And a woman was who had been subject to bleeding for 12 years. She had suffered a great deal under the care of many doctors and had spent all she had. Yet, instead of getting better, she grew worse. When she heard about Jesus, she came up behind him and the crowd behind him in the crowd and touched his cloak, because she thought, "If I just touch his clothes, I will be healed." Immediately, her bleeding stopped, and she felt in her body that she was free from her suffering. At once, Jesus realized that power had gone out of him. He turned around in the crowd and asked, "Who touched my clothes?" "You see the people crowding against you," his disciples answered, "and yet you can ask who touched me?" But Jesus kept looking around and see who had done it. Then the woman, knowing what had happened to her, came and fell in his feet and, trembling with fear, told him the whole truth. He said to her, "Daughter, your faith has healed you. Go in peace and be freed from your suffering." While Jesus was still speaking, some people came from the house of Jairus, the synagogue leader. "Your daughter is dead," they said. "Why bother the teacher anymore?" Overhearing what they said, Jesus told him, "Don't be afraid, just believe." He did not let anyone follow him except Peter, James, and John, the brother of James. When they came to the home of the synagogue leader, Jesus saw a commotion with people crying and wailing loudly. He went in and said to them, "Why all this commotion and wailing? The child is not dead, but asleep." But they laughed at him. After he put them all out, he took the child's father and mother and the disciples who were with him and went in where the child was. He took her by the hand and said to her, "Talita kaumi," which means, "Little girl, I said to you, get up." Immediately the girl stood up and began to walk around. She was 12 years old. At this, they were completely astonished. He gave strict orders not to let anyone know about this and told them to give her something to eat. This is the good news of Jesus Christ.
Praise to you, O Christ.
The grace of our Lord be with you all. You can be seated. Today we hear two stories of faith. Usually when we find ourselves in desperate situations, like when a loved one is dying or we're seriously ill, we tend to let go of indecisions or what we will usually do. And we're willing to try anything that might help. Some people will even do anything, no matter what. That is the situation in which the synagogue official finds himself today, and the woman with the hemorrhage. It begins with the story of Jairus, whose daughter is very ill. But this narrative is interrupted by that of a woman who suffered the hemorrhage. Jairus and the sick woman both go in search of Jesus' help. But where can they find Jesus? Of course, he is among people in need. In both stories, neither Jairus nor the woman have remedy. The woman has suffered a lot and had already seen many doctors, and the girl was dead when Jesus arrived. Even the men of Jairus' house came and said to Jairus, "Your daughter is dead. Why do you keep bothering the master?" But even so, the woman and Jairus trust Jesus. Miracles in the gospel prove Jesus had the power to heal and to give him life. Social class, status, and influence do not matter. Faith does. What attracts Jesus to the woman and Jairus is the same thing that draws him today, to us today, our faith. The place of a woman in the society of the time was very close to the heart of Jesus, and I love this. We see that although women were not allowed to approach or talk to a rabbi, Jesus does not treat women as less, but as full human beings. The woman who was healed by touching Jesus' garments approached him to tell him the whole truth. It was as if she once wanted to excuse herself for having broken the usual boundaries that separated this healer from the impure woman. Her blood issue would have made her unclean, and anyone who touched her was also declared unclean. The woman may have been wanting to sneak away after her healing and not to make public what he had done. But Jesus' response was simple. "Daughter, your faith has saved you. Go in peace. You have been healed of your affliction." She didn't have to go through the rituals to be declared clean, free from legal and spiritual contamination. No, she was lifted up by Jesus when he addressed her, "My daughter." We don't know her name, but what we know is that faith has saved her and that she is a daughter of Jesus, like the rest of us who are also saved by our faith. What nourishes the woman's faith? What gave her the courage to break through the crowd to reach out to Jesus and touch his garments? After all, she wasn't part of his inner circle, nor she was one of his male followers. The woman was like one of the psalmists who persist in their complaints to God, but who do not surrender to God. The woman's faith was the same persistent faith of her ancestors. That faith helped her to put aside fear and decorum to approach Jesus. Her only hope. I wonder if the woman's faith was an encouragement to Jairus since his daughter was already dead. I don't know. But what I do know is that God is not the author of death, nor does he delight in suffering. Also, God was not testing the faith of the woman of Jairus. Rather, Jesus showed God's will in miracles. God wants the fullness of life for us. Now, Jairus was a synagogue official, and not only did he go publicly to ask Jesus for help, but when he came to where Jesus was, he fell down at his feet and pleaded earnestly. Can you imagine? What a public display by a member of the opposite party. But wouldn't we also do everything we can to help someone we love, no matter what other things? Surely there were other ways Jairus could try to get help for his daughter. Surely he could have called the best doctors, but Jairus was already very desperate, and he knew that Jesus had been healing many people. In fact, in Mark's gospel, the healing flowed quickly, one after another. If Jesus could heal others, Jesus might have thought, maybe he can heal my daughter. The story of the woman healed of the hemorrhage and that of Jairus, whose daughter was restored to life, shows how God is present in our world in Jesus, responding to suffering, pain, and death. Jesus heals, brings us back to life, and restores relationships. He is present in need, responded with love, empathy, and compassion. And not only that, he shares our pain and our burdens, breaking prejudices and breaking the conventions that keep us, separate us from each other and from society. A person who is suffering can draw near to Jesus, and he affirms his presence in his faith to him. In today's gospel, we see how God deals with evil, pain, and death. So, brothers and sisters, the story of the woman and Jairus is also our story. When we are desperate, when we are afraid, when we face death, we can feel Jesus' touch, as the little girl felt Jesus' hand in hers. We need to hear Jesus affirm our faith and get up. God did not make death. Jesus has shown that in his hands we are imperishable. Jesus responds to the need with love, empathy, and compassion. He shares our pain and our burdens. He breaks prejudices and breaks conventions. Jesus is not afraid to enter the place where death seems to have its way and breaks the bonds of death and suffering. Jesus brings life and wants us to have it abundantly. Amen.